It's really nice to give a talk in this artificial intelligence in and for the Global South. So I'm really happy to contribute to that. So this presentation is about knowledge representation and reasoning, but then in a particular domain, namely the medical domain. And I have an example from the clinical guideline. So how can you represent such a clinical guideline? And how can you reason with such a clinical guideline? So as you know, in AI, there are different paradigms. Actually, two are rather important. That's the symbolic approach and the subsymbolic methods, which are more the data-driven methods. And this presentation is in the area of the symbolic approach. So here we use really explicit representation of knowledge, whereas in the subsymbolic approach, you do not do this. Now, as you know, the popularity of those two paradigms are rather changing over the time. Data-driven is the last couple of years, of course, very important and popular. And nowadays, actually, the combination of those different paradigm is also where people do a lot of research on. But this combination of combining data-driven and more knowledge-driven approaches is really outside the scope. So my focus is really on the knowledge representation part. So it is a knowledge-intensive system, so where we're talking about. So you have a medical decision support system for a particular goal, for instance, things as giving better care or lower the cost or finding new medical insights. You could have different medical tasks. So I give here some. So give support for guideline development or maybe enrollment of patients for a particular trial. You can give support for that. And that's done based on medical knowledge. And this medical knowledge, that could then be depending of the task, of course, a clinical guideline or clinical trial or quality indicators and so on. But also external knowledge sources. So we heard already from Victor about knowledge graphs that could be used here. Also patient data could be the input for such a medical decision support system. Of course, the main question is then, what kind of systems do you want to make? How do you interpret the data, the patient data? Which knowledge is useful to exploit? What is a useful system or effective system? But all those things, if you want to build certain kind of systems for those kind of tasks, we need a computer model for the medical knowledge. So we have to make the medical knowledge that's available more precise, it's interpretable for a computer. And that's really something that you have to do together with the medical expert and the knowledge engineer. So really you have to talk with medical experts to get this done. Okay, so this is a little bit difficult, but okay. So what we have is the medical knowledge. I would like to talk a little bit about the clinical guideline. We need for such a clinical guideline and computer model. There are different techniques for those models. So you can use logic or Bayesian networks or specialized languages for guidelines. And we develop one of those guidelines and I will talk languages. So I will talk about such a language. And then you have the medical decision support system where you do really the reasoning. And there, of course, that depends on what kind of model you choose or how the reasoning will be here. So the main idea of such a knowledge approach is that you construct a knowledge model. So that's a computer model, in this case, a computer interpretable clinical guideline. And then you use such a model for giving support for guideline-related tasks. And it could be various tasks. So you could use it for updating the guideline. You could use it for personalizing the guideline. But I will look in this presentation, to the guideline interaction detection. So how can you find interactions between the different guidelines? And I will also show how you could exploit existing knowledge sources for that. So first, the definition of the guideline. So clinical guidelines are systematically developed statements designed to help practitioners and patients to make decisions about appropriate healthcare for specific circumstances. And it's important to know that they are informed by systematic reviews of evidence, so there's really evidence involved, and an assessment of benefits of harms and alternative care options are given them. So it's a description of how a physician can help a patient, treating patient. So in diagnosing the patient, but also in treating the patient, and also in kind of following up the patient. An example of a recommendation is it's a guideline. The diabetes is, for instance, you should administer insulin to reduce the blood sugar. So that's what you want to do there. Now, the motivation of guidelines, of course, they are meant for improving quality of care. So there's a specialized team that will develop a particular guideline, and then everyone can use this guideline. It's then also available for all patients, so that's important that all people get, in principle, the same, could use the same knowledge for what we know about the treatment for a particular disease. And of course, it's also cost reduction because it's protocolized, so you can really reuse as I mentioned already, in the guidelines, it's important that it's an evidence involved in. So it's based on the clinical trials and the literature. And this evidence is on different levels. So you can have very high level of evidence when you are using randomized control trials, a little bit less evidence at level that they considered if you only use cohort studies, and expert opinions, that's actually not really evidence. So that scores low on this. It may be good to know that in the beginning, everything was actually more or less expert opinions and not really based on evidence. But nowadays, we really would like to have the highest as possible of this evidence. Then we have recommendations, which are the main part of the guideline. And there we have different strengths of recommendation, and the strength of the recommendation depends, of course, on the quality of the evidence that you have. So if you have high quality evidence, then the recommendation is also better or stronger. But it also depends whether the literature that is taken into account is also applicable to that country that you want to apply the guideline on. And also whether the evidence that's consistency there, so that you do not have contradicting evidence. That's also something that you take into account if you talk about the strength of the recommendation. Then there are most of the times they are using those recommendations as strong recommendations that you really should do something, or a strong recommendation that you really should not do something, or it's more on a condition, or it's a little bit lower, it's more best practice. So that's what they are usually doing, but it's actually based on the clinical experience. Important to know is that a guideline is always per disease. So for diabetes, you have a guideline. For every disease, there is a guideline. And we will see later on that we also want to apply several guidelines. But first, I would like to look to the representation of the guideline. So you would like to go from the text and the figures and the flowcharts, etc., that are in the guideline to a model that you can use in the computer. And this is rather important to make this step, because if you model this guideline, you also identify actually anomalies. So the text is not that clear as you would expect. So by making this modeling step, you improve the quality of the guidelines, because you see ambiguities, things are not clear, or you're missing information, you miss conditions, when do you exactly apply a particular treatment. or things are inconsistent, so or redundant. It's places. It's mentioned in several places in the guideline. So only the modeling aspect is already important. Now, the way we model citizen guideline is based on the recommendations. So that's what you want to model. In the guideline, you have a causation belief, what we call. And that means that if you have an action, tramadol, then you assume that if you give this tramadol, that the blood coagulation from normal goes to low. So you expect you believe that this transition will happen. And so you go from normal to low, and the evidence level that you have is high for that. And the actual recommendation is that if you want to avoid thrombi, then you should do this action, administer tramadol. So that's the way the modeling items that we are using for the guideline. So here we see another one. Another way of avoiding thrombi is that you should administer NSAID. And then also you have a blood coagulation that goes from normal to low. And here you see you have medium level of evidence. You can imagine that you have many of those kinds of elements in the guideline, and that's what you have to model, of course. So a number of those elements forms the actual guideline, such as we see it on paper. This can be translation in more technical details. So we use here semantic web technology to realize it for the computer. But as I said, the diagnosis, the guidelines are really per disease. And it turns out that people have often, and particularly elderly people, have more than one disease. So we would like to somehow combine those guidelines. So here you can see how important it is that we look also to this type of patients, so patients that suffer on more than one disease. So if you look, for instance, here to the people, elderly people, 65, 17, then you see already that 30% has three disorders and 50% has two disorders. So this is a real important situation that you really want to apply different guidelines. I will show this in an example, how you could use those different guidelines. And I will take as example the guidelines from osteoarthritis, hypertension, and diabetes, because this is a rather common combination of diseases in elderly people. Now, the problem that are here is, of course, that there is a large variety of combination of diseases. So you do not want to spell it out for every combination, but you would like to have a generic method because many combinations are possible, so many diseases, many guidelines, but also they are from rather different disciplines. So it's rather difficult for the physician to know about the field, another field, so to speak. So therefore, you would really give some support to those physicians to see how those, for this particular patient, the guidelines will interact. So what we are looking for is a method that takes as input the guideline models and then derives the guideline interactions. So then you have first the advantage of modeling a guideline and identify already all kinds of anomalies. So you can improve the guideline already. And then later on, you can, when you want to apply it for a patient that has multiple diseases, then you can see where the interactions are. And then the physician, the doctor should decide what is then a good choice, of course. So here we see the different guidelines. So this is diabetes that we already saw. Here's another one from osteoarthritis. So for avoiding bleeding, you should not administer aspirin, because this is something that increase the risk of bleeding. So that's exactly what you do not want. And the evidence turns out to be high level here. Here you see another one. If you need to heal the pain, then you should administer ibuprofen, because then you go from pain to no pain. But the evidence for this is low. Now another one about blood pressure, and of course this is just one that I took as example. The guideline is much much larger, of course. But the issue is here that we would like, for a multimorbid patient with those three diseases, we would apply all those guidelines, but we want to avoid that there is some how interaction between the guideline that's not good for patients. So for instance, if we look to the combination of diabetes and osteoarthritis, then you see that in one case, here you want to avoid thrombi, so you should give, concerning the blood coagulation, administer NSAID. But if you look to the osteoarthritis guideline, then you you would like to avoid bleeding, and then that means that you should not give an aspirin. And an aspirin is a form of an NSAID, so that means that those two are in contradiction. So if you know this, then a better idea for avoiding thrombi is to take an alternative. So to take this one for that particular patient that also suffers on osteoarthritis. So by giving these interactions, the physician could make a better choice for what to give for the patient, what to do for this. Now it's the way we identify those interactions are based on rules. So here you see the rule that that I just mentioned, for example, the positive recommendation of a particular recommendation. In this one case, this administration of NSAID, and a negative recommendation, so you should not give this aspirin, they are conflicting. But important to see here is that this rule is really generic. So you are talking here about recommendations and actions. So that means that you can apply this on all the models that you have, or all the snippets that you have for your different guidelines. So here you see also a contradiction, one from osteoarthritis, and the other one was from hypertension. Hypertension. So you. For avoiding high blood pressure, you should not administer NSAID, but for the pain, you should give ibuprofen, but those are also interacting because you know that ibuprofen is an NSAID. And here you see the same. So it's important to realize that those rules are generic, such that we can apply them on all those different cases. And of course, these rules can we express more precisely in logic, and then implement it in Prolog, for instance. Now, we identified several types of interactions. So this is another type of interaction. So repetition of actions for different purposes. So the example is you would like to administer aspirin to reduce the risk of thrombus. But you could also administer aspirin to relieve pain or for handling inflammation. But if all those three are given by different physicians, you would like to know this, because then you would like to optimize this recommendation of giving this particular aspirin as drug. So several of these types of interactions can be given. So you could have a repetition or a contradiction or an alternative that we have already seen, or a opposed belief or repeated side effects. And all those interactions can be expressed in those kind of generic rules. As I mentioned earlier, we would also like to exploit knowledge that's already there. So a good example of knowledge that's already available is CIDA, which contains information on drugs and also drug bank. And those sources are already in structured form, so they can be easily used, and even they are already open and available over the internet. So I heard also Victor talking about those kind of knowledge sources before. And of course, it is important that if you use such a source, that you know whether it's trustful. So, and if you look to the drug bank, for instance, this is the authority's FDA. So that's, you can use this data because it's really trustful. So what we then do is, so here you have an impression of how many data, the knowledge sources are available in the medical area already. But in my talk, I will only use this CIDA and drug bank. So what we are doing then is expressing this CIDA knowledge actually also as a causation belief. So we put it in the same way as that we have the knowledge from the clinical guideline. So from CIDA, we find out that there was the causation belief that if you do an administer thiazide, then the blood sugar level will increase. So it will become higher. So if you know that, and you relate that to the other knowledge sources that you have, or the other snippets of the guidelines that you have, then you can also use this knowledge for finding interactions between the guideline or things that do not work well together. So here you see from the hypertension guideline that it is a good idea to reduce the blood pressure. So therefore you should administer thiazide. But if you look to the diabetes guideline, you should reduce the sugar level. So it would be a good idea to administer insulin. But if you see the knowledge from CIDA, then you see that if you do this administration of thiazide, then the blood sugar level increase. So that's something that you do not want. So enriching the guideline actually with all those kind of additional information or additional knowledge, we are able to identify even more interactions. So if you see here the different guidelines, the diabetes one, the osteoarthritis, and hypertension. You see also here several blocks that I mentioned. They are coming from the knowledge external knowledge sources. So CIDA, here you see drug bank as additional knowledge, and those can be used for finding the different interactions. So we can find contradictions. You can see, you can find here alternatives. You can use those incompatible knowledge to identify that those two are not going well together. So this shows you that you can really use different kind of knowledge from other knowledge sources. Of course, they should be trustful. So CIDA and drug bank, that's the case. And for the others, we model them by ourselves. And then we can use those generic rules to identify all those interactions. And then the physician could take a look of this and then decide what to do with those interactions, of course. So the conclusion is actually that this certain computer model for clinical guidelines is very useful in this case for improving the quality of the guideline itself already, but also for using it in a particular task, namely the interactions between different guidelines. And of course, this is done then in a generic way, such you can do it on all kinds of different combinations of diseases. And we use this knowledge that's already there, that is very good to incorporate, because this makes the possible that you find even more interactions. So that means that actually, if you have a set of guideline models, then you get the interactions for free, because that's what you can automate. So back to our knowledge approach, the guideline model can be reused also for other tasks. So here I showed the example only of interactions of guidelines, but you could also use it for updating the guideline. So you use the model that you make from the guideline for searching for additional literature, and then try to incorporate it in the guideline. Or you try to use the guideline model to make a model and a guideline that's easy to understand for a patient. So for all those kind of things, you could use the guideline model, and then you do another task, another reasoning process around that model. So if we go back to the original figure that I had, the knowledge intensive systems. So what we did, we looked to the medical knowledge, but in particular to this clinical guideline. We want to make a computer model out of this. There are several techniques for this, but I showed the one where we modeled the guideline with this transition and causal belief and recommendations. And then we go to the reasoning part. So what is the task that we are doing? That was the identification of the guideline interactions. And we did this in a way where we use those generic rules. And the reason why we did this is to get better care, because now we are able to also treat people with several diseases in a consistent way. If you want to read more on this, I would like to mention those papers. This is work that I did together with Veruska. She was one of my PhD students in the past. There's also a prototype if you want to play around a little bit with those interactions. Okay, so thank you for your attention.
Yeah, thank you very much. Very intriguing and very interesting. As usual, if there are any questions, just raise your hand or put them in the comment section. And I think maybe I would like to start with a question. Oh, I see Anna's hand is up.
Please start. Anna, yeah.
All right, so I just wanted to find out, so with these interactions, it's my assumption that these are readily, for example, with the external sources that you mentioned, these are available, more like available metadata that you can access. And seeing as we are talking about the Global South, I'm just wondering if these various interactions are in any way problematic when it comes to, let's say, places like Africa. A quick example I can give is, for example, if a European should have a headache, most likely or should have a headache and a fever, most likely the interactions will probably not point to malaria. But if an African has the same condition, most likely it is malaria. And I'm wondering whether these interactions are in any way biased towards the Western world, and if there needs to be more input from the Global South to have interactions that actually apply to the diseases and conditions that we have.
I see what you mean, yeah. Yeah, so the the guideline model that's based on the guideline. But I can imagine that those kind of interactions are different for different areas, so that the drug bank or the drug interactions there are given, which are focused on a particular area. So I can imagine that that is different. But I'm not sure what the current status is of what kind of knowledge are involved there, whether that's also based on other countries, so to speak. But I can definitely imagine that that's the case. And maybe another task, but also is related to the South, is the adaptation of the clinical guidelines. So if you have a model, then you would also like to somehow adapt it to the situation where it is placed in. And this can be done in several ways. It can be done with respect to the country. So, but it could also be done with respect to the hospital. So what are the equipment that they have, etc. So that's also an adaptation of the guideline. And then you could use the guideline model, the original one, and then see what kind of adaptation you need. But then still you have the first step of the model, I would say. Yeah. So this is also a field that is people trying to do that. And also for the development of own guidelines, that they start from an existing one instead from starting from scratch.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Anna?
Yeah, thank you, Annette, for a nice talk and very interesting. But a lot of things related to what Francis is asking came to my mind. For example, I know from different countries that there are different guidelines. For example, if you in Brazil, you have a headache, a doctor will never give you paracetamol. And in Netherlands, that's the first thing they give you. And for example, even in the Netherlands, when I had my child, I was born in the VU hospital. And there they said she was premature. She should not have not be breastfed in the first few weeks. And then I went to another hospital in the center of Amsterdam where they said, we give immediately breastfeeding to the children when they are premature. So the guidelines are sometimes conflicting and how should you go with such a model where there are conflicting models or even maybe fuzzy knowledge?
Yeah, so those conflicts notice those because these are also the interactions. So the inconsistency that you find out that they give a particular you would like to reach it on a particular goal on different ways, and those things are conflicting with each other. That's what you mean. So that's exactly what we are aiming at, but. In the case of your example with the hospital, they use actually also two different guidelines. Eh? So then you should also model both parts of that guideline, of course.
Yeah, exactly. I was asking exactly when the guidelines are totally contrary.
But then you should make the model from that, from both guidelines, and then you can see where the interaction is or where the difference is or where you find alternatives for particular actions or goals.
Does this have to do with assumptions, so that assumptions are different for different guidelines and that these are hidden maybe?
Yeah, that's what I tried to say in the beginning. If you make this model, then you really notice that although it looks like very complex and complete, it is often not the case. And then you are missing a condition. When do you exactly give a particular medication or to which person on which condition, then it's much more vague. And that's already the first win if you start with this kind of modeling. But I have also to be honest, it's rather takes a lot of time to model those guidelines. So that means it might be also good to focus on particular parts which are more important than other parts or more difficult than other parts, or you would expect more interactions from those parts. Because it's rather it's rather complex to model the guideline. But if you model the guideline, then you get the interactions for free. So that's the balance that you have to make.
Thank you.